Hello guys, welcome to another video. Today we are going to talk about intangible asset. This is the first video relevant to the intangible assets. So in this video, we are going to look at the basic definition, the concept of intangible assets, initial recognition of intangible assets, and then we are going to perform a couple of questions, exam standard question, to make sure whatever we have discussed, we are clear with this concept. So here we go with the definition first. An intangible asset is an identifiable asset. These assets are non-monetary assets. And third, these assets lack the physical substance. So these three keywords are there. So if any asset will not fulfill this criteria, we should not classify as intangible asset. So first we need to understand what does mean by identifiable asset. So the an intangible asset is an identifiable asset if it is separable. Separable mean to say this asset could be bought or sold separately, or you can look the word here, or this asset is gonna to convey to the holder contractual or legal rights to receive the future economic benefit. To understand this, I can just quote an example for franchises, because franchise rights are also our intangible asset. So let's have a look what is the franchise first. A franchise agreement is a legal binding contract between a franchisor and franchisee. Franchisor is the party who established the brand's trademark or the trade name and the business system. For example, you can see here the Etisalat, there is a one company which is called Etisalat in GCC. This is one of the largest telecommunication company. So maybe the Etisalat might give the right to any other party to sell their product or their services. So here the franchisor will be the Etisalat, because Etisalat has established the brand's trademark or the trade name and the business system. And on the other hand, we have one party which is called franchisee. Okay. Franchisee actually is the party who pays a royalty and often an initial fee for the right to do business under the franchisor's name and system. For example, it could be any XYZ. Maybe he is going to take a license or the right from the Etisalat to sell their products. But the franchisee, of course, will pay the royalties and maybe initial license fee also to the Etisalat. So it means here, if you will look from the franchisee point of view, who is selling the goods under the name, goods or services under the name of Etisalat. So it means he is having a contractual or legal rights to receive future economic benefit. Okay, this is what is your identifiable asset. Don't forget these two words are there. So an asset is identifiable if it is separable, or it could be bought or sold separately, or if it conveys to the holder contractual or legal rights. And second keyword we have here, non-monetary assets. Actually, non-monetary assets are those assets, okay, which does not have a precise dollar value. Like you don't have any exact amount. For example, if you want to sell that asset, maybe you can sell for $5,000, or maybe you can sell for $7,000, but it don't have exact amount. Like amount is not known, exact amount is not known, okay? So which don't have a precise dollar value, and it is not easily convertible into cash, okay? So this is what is called your non-monetary asset. And as you know, our non-current assets are non-monetary assets because they don't have precise dollar value, and it is not easily, these assets are not easily convertible to cash or cash equivalents. Okay. And the third we have here, a keyword which is called lacks the physical substance. Physical substance means say we cannot touch these assets. Okay, this is what is called intangible asset definition. So here we go. So we have here three attributes of the intangible assets, three main attributes, you can say three main characteristics of the intangible asset. Number one is called, what is the identifiability? Of course, it should be identifiable. Second, actually, this is the definition of asset. So the entity must have a control over the asset. Control means to say we have a power to obtain benefit from the asset. This is what is called control. And the third word is what? So from these assets, we expect future economic benefit. Future economic benefit means say either these assets will increase the revenue in the future for the company who control the asset, or maybe it will reduce the cost, future cost, okay, for the company. So by the way, you are going to get the benefit. So these are three attributes of intangible assets. So here we have let me give you example. What are our intangible assets here, the examples? So we have a number of different examples. For example, your license might be intangible assets, okay? Your patents are also your intangible assets. Your copyrights also your intangible assets. Your franchise rights are also your intangible assets, and your trademarks are also your intangible assets. So let me explain one by one. Starting from patent, for example, let me just give you example. Nowadays, you know, as we are facing COVID-19, and now we have a different pharmaceutical companies from different countries, they are trying to invent the medicine for COVID-19. For example, there is a company A. This company has invented, just assume, the medicine for COVID-19. So what they can do, they can apply for the patent. Okay, patent mean to say the patent is a type of intangible asset that gives its owner the legal right to exclude others from making, using, or selling an invention. So it means if you will get a patent, maybe you got a patent from government for 5 years. So it means for 5 years, no one can copy your formula. So these patents are, these legal rights are also your intangible assets. Okay. Then we have a copyrights. For the copyright, simply what we can say, the copyrights I'm going to explain now. The copyright is also another type of intangible asset that gives its owner the exclusive rights to make copies of the creator work. Maybe, for example, if you have created any a musical material, okay, so maybe for that musical material you can take a copyright only. You can copy, if someone, some other companies will try to copy your material, so you can claim copyrights. Okay, so this is what is the copyrights. Like, for example, if you are author of the book, so you might give the copyrights to a specific publishing company. Only that company can make a copies of your books. Okay, so this is also example of the intangible assets. Okay, and then we have here another word which is called trademarks. You know, for example, if you will look at the car, so maybe you can identify this car belongs to the Toyota company or BMW. Why we can say this? Because due to the trademark. So what is actually the trademark? Trademark is a type of intellectual property or intangible asset consisting of a recognizable sign, design, or expression which identifies the product or services of a particular source. As I gave you example, for example, if you will look at the car, so easily you can identify due to the symbol which is placed on the front of the car. Like, is it Toyota cars, or is it belong to BMW? So this is what is called trademark. So I have already given you the example for franchise, and please note license also your intangible assets. Okay, so this is what is the definition of intangible asset. Now here we go. We have here a note, really important note. So intangible assets can take many forms. Okay, for example, actually there are different types of categories of intangible asset. Like, as I give you example, the trademarks are relevant to the marketing. Okay, these are marketing related intangible assets. Customer list is also our intangible asset because it is identifiable. Okay, this customer list, and it without physical existence. So this is also your intangible assets. So then we have where copyrights, as I told you, copyrights mostly it is for artistic related. Then we have a franchise rights, which is related to the contracts. Then you have a technology related intangible assets like a computer softwares, because they don't also have a physical existence. Plus they are identifiable and non-monetary assets. And here we also sometimes say goodwill is intangible asset, but goodwill we cannot fit in the definition. So that is why goodwill we will cover in a separate video. Okay, there I will talk about how to calculate the goodwill in case of business combination. and how we can calculate the impairment of the goodwill. Okay, so but in this definition we cannot fit the goodwill whatever we have discussed. So here we have here now initial recognition. Please note guys, this video specifically I'm making for CMA students and CPA students because I'm going to explain as per US GAAP. Okay, so if you are IFRS students, I will try to explain basic difference also. So here we go guys. First of all, we have here externally acquired intangible assets. Externally acquired, like of course your intangible assets might have two types. It might have a internally developed intangible assets. It might include externally acquired intangible assets. Okay, so here please note under US GAAP. So if you want to see accounting for internally developed intangible asset, because I'm going to talk about initial recognition. Initial recognition means say first time at which value we should record the assets in our financial statement. So for internally developed, please remember whatever the cost you will incur, like you will incur the research and development cost under US GAAP. This research and development cost you will record as expense immediately. Okay, but under IFRS there are certain conditions. If those conditions are fulfilled, you can record the development cost as cap asset. Okay, you can capitalize the development cost. But under US GAAP, just let me explain first GAAP throughout. Okay, at the end I will try to cover IFRS difference also. For the internally developed intangible assets, so all the research and development cost must be recorded expense immediately. Then what should be capitalized? The point is which value. If for example, if you have any intangible assets, okay, which is internally developed, if like patent, for example, you have incurred millions of dollars for the invention of the COVID-19 medicine. So you have done research and development work. So all the research and development cost you will record as a expense. Okay, so then which value we can capitalize? So please remember here, intangible assets are recorded initially at amount of additional cost other than those research and development expenditures. So now here, what it might include the additional cost, for example, it might include the legal fee, or maybe it might include the registration fee only, for example, for the COVID-19. Okay, you have incurred $1 million for research and development. So this $1 million should be recorded as expense. Maybe just you have paid $2,000 as a legal or registration fee. So you are allowed to capitalize only this much money. Okay, the additional cost. Okay, but for the externally acquired intangible asset, now I'm going to talk about externally acquired intangible assets other than goodwill. So or initially recorded at acquisition cost mean to say like whatever the cost you have incurred, okay, directly associated cost with the assets. Okay, like it might include purchase price plus import duties plus additional costs such as legal fees, registration fee. Please remember, so non-refundable taxes, if you have paid any tax you can also capitalize. Training costs you will never capitalize. Administration cost you will never capitalize. Okay, and I will show you with the help of the questions also. But for the externally acquired intangible asset, whatever the cost you have incurred to acquire that asset, purchase price plus import duty plus legal or registration fee, you can capitalize all those costs. Okay, so this is what is the rule for externally acquired intangible assets. So if you know the amount, now for example for internally or externally acquired asset, if you know the amount, so with that amount you will debit the asset and you will credit the cash. Okay, asset means intangible asset. So here we go, let's have a look with the help of examples, and we will also talk about with the questions, with the help of questions also. So here we have a company invested $200,000 and $300,000 in research phase and development phase respectively. It means this should also be recorded as expense, and development cost should also be recorded as a expense. Okay, of an internally developed patent. In addition, the company paid $10,000 and $15,000 for the patent registration fee and legal fee respectively. Of course, The legal and registration fee you can capitalize. It means only 25,000, which is 10,000 plus 15,000 is equal to 25,000. This amount you can capitalize. So you will double the asset with 25,000, like patent, and credit the cash by 25,000. Okay. Now here we have another point. Please remember also, this is also examinable point. We have here organization and startup cost. Okay. Like for example, what are the organization and startup cost? Organization cost are those costs incurred in the formation of the business. Like you are going to maybe register a company. So at that time you will incur certain cost. So those costs are called promotion cost. Organization and startup cost. And these costs mostly includes what? Payment to the promoters, legal and accounting fees, and cost of registering with the state, like whatever you have paying, you have paid registration fee also. Please remember here, sometime, you know, companies issued the stock at the start and you might pay certain underwriter's cost. Please, you cannot, that and that stock related issue cost is not your startup cost, please. That is separate. And we will talk about in the equity accounting, because the stocks related issue cost, which you even, you will incur at the time of initial offer. So that should be reduced, that should be deducted from the proceed. Okay, it should not be recorded as expense, separate expense, please note. So what is the point here? So the point is that all the costs which you will incur for the organization and startup, so these costs must be recorded as expense, must be recorded as expense. And this rule is for non-governmental entities, okay? What we do for the governmental entities, that we will cover in the government accounting. But for the normal private businesses, whatever you have startup cost you have incurred, so these costs must be recorded as expense immediately. Okay, so here we go. Here we have here questions. Let's look at the question first. For example, here we have a question number one. They're telling you an entity purchased a trademark. This is the purchased, it's externally acquired trademark, and incurs the following cost in connection with the trademark. So here the cost number one is one-time trademark purchase price. Purchase price is how much? 100,000. Of course, this should be capitalized. This should be capitalized. Non-refundable VAT taxes. Non-refundable, yes, it should also be capitalized. But if it is refundable, then it should not be capitalized. Please note, okay? If it is refundable, then we will not capitalize. Training cost, training sales personnel on the use of new trademark, this is not capitalized. We will not capitalize. Research and development cost will be recorded as expense immediately. So this is also not going to be capitalized. Then here we have a legal cost incurred to register the trademark. Yes, this is going to be capitalized. Okay, so this is going to be capitalized. And salaries of administration personnel, no, it's not going to be capitalized. It means which cost you will capitalize? 100,000 plus 5,000 and plus 10,500. So here, what is the question? The question is, assuming that the trademark meets all of the applicable initial asset recognition criteria, the entity should recognize an asset in the amount of what? Of course, in the amount of 115,500, because it includes purchase price plus non-refundable taxes plus legal fee. Okay, so this is what is the correct option. Now let's have a look here. Question number two, on June 30, year 5, Finn Inc. exchanged 2,000 shares. So please remember, this is the exchange. Okay, 2,000 shares of Edlo Corporation, $30 par value. Like you are going to exchange 2,000 stocks with the par value of $30 of the common stock for the patent owned. Actually, what's happening? You are going to buy a patent, okay? And you are going to transfer the stocks. You're going to transfer the stocks. So this is what is going to be exchanged, okay? Patent with the stocks. The Edlo stock was acquired in year one at the cost of 50,000. This is the cost when you acquired these stocks with the 50,000 at exchange date. This is really important. At the date of exchange, Edlo's common stock had a fair value of $40 per share, and the patent had the net carrying amount of 100,000 on the BISC books, because you are going to exchange with the BISC. The fin should record the patent at what? Of course, guys, because it's exchange transaction, we have already covered the exchange of assets. Okay. So guys, whenever you are going to exchange anything, so first of all, this is the rule. The cost of acquired asset, like the asset which you are going to acquire, here is the patent. The cost of acquired asset should be equal to what? Fair value of asset given in the exchange transaction. Like you have to take fair value of the asset given. Fair value. Until unless the fair value of asset received is more evident. So here, of course, patent fair value is not available. Asset received fair value is not available. But fair value of asset given up is available. Which asset you have given up? You have given the stocks, your investment, which includes 2000 stocks, and the fair value of the stocks are $40. So fair value, don't take acquisition cost, don't take par value, you have to take a fair value. Okay, so it means 2000 times $40, which is the fair value at the date of exchange. So it means you will record the patent at 80,000. So you will debit the patent and credit your investment, because if you have treated as investments. Okay, so it means the answer is C is the correct answer. So here we have another question. Question number three, which of the following expenditure qualifies for asset capitalization? Like which amounts you can capitalize? Number one, for option A, cost of material used in prototype. No, prototype, when you make any prototype, so it's considered as development phase. So of course, research and development phase, of course, the research and development cost you cannot capitalize. You have to record as a expense. Then option B, the cost of testing a prototype. Again, it's a research and development phase. It should be recorded as expense. It should not be capitalized. C, salaries of engineering staff developing a new product. Of course, it is a research and development phase. Again, it should be recorded as expense. It should not be capitalized. D is legal cost associated with obtaining patent on the new product. Yes, this legal fee you can capitalize. It means option D is correct. Then we have another question. Wind company incurs recognition cost of 600,000. This is organization cost of 600, like it's a startup cost. At the beginning of the first year of the operation, how should Wind treat the organization cost in the financial statement in accordance with the US GAAP? Of course, you have to record this startup cost or organization cost as an expense. So it's never amortized. Reason is that you will not capitalize in financial accounting. Okay, but in tax purpose you can capitalize, but in financial accounting you cannot, you should not capitalize. Then amortized over 180 months. No, there is no point in amortization because you are not going to capitalize it at all. So then amortized over 40 years. No, so these should be expensed immediately. Yes, this is how you will deal with it. Now guys, if you are IFRS student, please remember here we have a rule for development cost. For the initial recognition, I'm just going to cover. So under IFRS, the development. So please remember, under IFRS, research cost must be expensed as incurred. But for the development cost, it could be capitalized, but if it will meet the criteria. What are the criteria? So here, please remember here, the first criteria is what? This development cost, whatever you have incurred. So these costs are the product is technical feasible, okay? Like you should remember, it's a technical feasible of the completion of the asset. This product is technical feasible, and you have intention to complete also. This is the second condition. Third, you have a ability to use or sell the asset, like once it will be developed. So you have ability to use it or the sell it. This is the third criteria. For the way in which it will generate a probable future benefit, you are aware how you can get the future benefit. Okay, through use or through the sale, and you have resources available to complete this one. Okay, and the number six is you have ability to measure reliably expenditures attributable to the asset, like cost is reliably measured. If these conditions are met, so you can capitalize the development cost. Okay, so but research cost should always be expensed out. But for the GAAP student, of course, research and development both costs should be recorded as expense. I hope guys it is clear. That is enough for this video. In the next video I will talk about subsequent measurement. Okay, that we will see in the next video. Thank you so much. Bye bye.